Right Honourable Subhash Nirmanji, my colleague Thakur Sharmaji, dignitaries of the dais, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be back in Nepal after exactly 2 years. I was here in an earlier avatar when I was dealing with power and commerce, and today I'm here as Minister for Environment and Forests. And my presence here really is to convey two essential messages. First, the desire of the Government of India to build a closer partnership with various institutions in Nepal in the field of environmental management, forestry, and climate change. And second, the desire of the Government of India to deepen its relationship with ISIMOD, and I'll have something to say about this later when I visit ISIMOD during the afternoon. We are a country, India is a country, profoundly affected by climate change. Perhaps no other country in the world has these multiple points of vulnerability as India has. Over 60% of our cultivated area is rain-fed and dependent on the southwest monsoon. Over 300 million people live in peninsular India, extremely vulnerable to increase in mean sea level. We have our natural resources, which are in heavily forested areas, whether it's coal, whether it's iron ore, whether it's manganese. These are all located in forest areas. And more extraction of minerals to fuel our economic growth means more deforestation. And of course, we have the water security of a large part of the Indian subcontinent dependent on the health of the Himalayan glaciers. There is really no country in the world which has all these four points of vulnerability. And therefore, as a country so profoundly affected by what is going to happen to climate change, we take our responsibilities very seriously. We did not cause the problem of global warming, but India certainly wants to be part of the solution to global warming. And it is in this spirit that India has participated in the global negotiations that are going on, which went on in Copenhagen, which will now take place in Cancun and thereafter. And we are as keen as anybody else to craft an international agreement in which each country takes upon itself responsibilities for mitigating greenhouse gas emissions and also doing its bit to helping countries like Nepal, Bangladesh, Maldives, and Bhutan and other countries adapt to the impacts of climate change. For this, investment in climate science is essential. We need to understand what are the drivers of climate change, what is driving global warming. And nothing illustrates this need for investment than the controversy that erupted earlier this year on the Himalayan glaciers issue. And I want to say something on the Himalayan glaciers, because this is something that affects all of us very, very on a day-to-day basis, something that we see around us, and on which, if I might say so, on which reams and reams of material have been written, and which, as you know, created controversy, and finally IPCC had to even retract some of its statements. Now, I think the first thing that we must understand about the Himalayan glaciers is that they are fundamentally different from the polar glaciers, from the European glaciers. Because the snout of the Himalayan glaciers is at a higher elevation, it's 3,000 meters over sea level. So straightforward extrapolation from what is happening to the polar glaciers to what is going to happen to the Himalayan glaciers is simply not relevant. And this was the fundamental reason why this controversy got erupted. Because from the behavior of the European and the polar glaciers, the IPCC came out with an astounding statement that the Himalayan glaciers will vanish by the year 2035. I took objection to that statement, and we did a lot of our own analysis. I put together a group of Indian scientists to tell me what is the real science, what is actually happening to the Himalayan glaciers. And the truth is that what is happening in the Himalayan glaciers is incredibly more complex, incredibly more nuanced than what we are led to believe. Most glaciers are indeed melting. Most glaciers are indeed retreating, and that is cause for concern. The health of most glaciers is very poor, and that is cause for concern. But surprisingly, some glaciers are actually advancing. The famous Siachen Glacier, which is in the news for a variety of other reasons, is an example of a glacier which has been found to be actually advancing. The Gangotri Glacier, which is of great importance as far as the River Ganges is concerned, the Gangotri Glacier is actually receding, but at a decelerating rate. The rate of retreat of the Gangotri Glacier is coming down over the last 2-3 decades. The point I want to make is not to challenge the scientific wisdom that glaciers are in retreat, but to establish the fact that we need to understand in a much closer, much deeper, and more extensive manner the behavior of this great ecosystem of the Himalayas. Because what is happening is something much more complex than what you see by reading newspapers or popular journals. And this is why the Indian government very recently has established a National Institute of Himalayan Glaciology. This is in Dehradun. This will be a national center which would take upon itself the responsibility of what I call the 3M: measuring, modeling, and monitoring. We need to measure what is happening, we need to model what is happening, and we need to monitor what is happening. We have launched a major program in this National Institute of Himalayan Glaciology, not just for understanding what is happening to the Himalayan glaciers through greenhouse gas emissions, but we have also launched a national program for understanding what is going to happen to black carbon and the impact of black carbon, atmospheric black carbon in soot, which has also been very much in the news, what the impact of that is on the health of the Himalayan glaciers. We are convinced that this program will succeed only if we bring our neighboring countries also in the rubric of this partnership. And that is why I am here today to discuss with my colleague, the government of Nepal, and with BCMOL, how we can have regional programs in the field of mountain ecology, regional programs in the field of glaciology, so that we understand in a collaborative mode what is happening to this lifeline of our societies. And I, on behalf of the government of India, would like to clearly and categorically state that in this program of climate science, in this program of monitoring, measuring, and modeling, we would like to have partnerships with other countries in our region. I'm very happy that through the initiative of ECMOD, for the first time, India, Nepal, and China have started a regional program on eco-restoration and biodiversity management in the Mount Kailash habitat. I think that's a good starting point. It's a small step forward, but it's a good starting point for these collaborative partnerships that I'm talking about. By October 2012, India will launch its own greenhouse gas and aerosol monitoring satellite. We invite partnerships from our regional countries, from our neighbors, to participate in the actual use of the data that the satellite is going to throw up. And by the middle of 2013, India is going to be launching its own dedicated forestry satellite in order to be able to measure and monitor on a real-time, daily basis what is happening to biodiversity and forestry. Last evening, over dinner, I made an offer which was readily accepted by my colleagues, the Minister for Forests and the Minister for Environment, and we will start a program whereby scholars from Nepalese institutions, the Nepal Academy of Sciences, the universities, we will associate them with our institutions. And for a starter, we have said that 2 Nepalese scientists will come to these institutions, spend 6 months, be part of our network of climate change monitoring. We have a comprehensive network of 128 research institutions, about 270 scientists who are involved in climate change assessment. We would very much like, we welcome the participation of institutions from Nepal. And to begin with, 2 fellowships are going to be awarded only condition that I have put is that these people must be below the age of 35. So that we should train, we should build the capacity, we should train the next generation of researchers so that, you know, we create institutions. Ultimately, it is my hope that we will have institutions in Nepal which would, on an equal footing, work within the best institutions in the world. So as a country, although we are the world's third largest emitter, we are deeply conscious of the need to manage our emissions consistent with our economic growth aspirations, but at the same time, do our bit in order to build the capacity in our own region to understand, to monitor, to appreciate better what is happening, why climate is changing, why global warming is taking place, and the various impacts it is having on different facets of our economy. Earlier this year, in May, India became the first developing country to release its own greenhouse gas inventory for the year 2007. No country in the world has greenhouse gas inventory. No developing country in the world, at least, has a greenhouse gas inventory for the year 2007. We released this as a proof, as a demonstration of our seriousness in this area.